Senate will come to order. I ask all present to please rise and join with me as we recite the Pledge of Allegiance to our flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Today's invocation will be offered by Rabbi Eli J. Mansour, lead rabbi of the Edmund J. Safra Synagogue in Brooklyn. Rabbi?
Members of the Senate, I would like to read an invocation of an old prayer originally written in Hebrew. I will translate it into English. Master of the universe, God of all works, who extends peace like a river and like a rapid stream the glory of nations, look down from your holy dwelling and bless this land, the United States of America, wherein we dwell. Let not violence be heard in their land, wasting and destruction within their boundaries, but you shall call its walls salvation and its gates praise. Grant them rain in due season, so that the earth shall yield her products, and the tree of the field shall yield its fruit, and grant peace, goodness, and a blessing on all the inhabitants of the land, that they may lie down with none to make them afraid. Pour down the bounty of your goodness upon them. Ordain blessings to all the prestigious members of this state senate. Teach them the good ways wherein they should walk, so as to judge with clarity of mind, fairness, and abundance of peace. Members of the Senate, a personal blessing, as I have committed myself as a rabbi and a teacher, I bless you that you shall continue to invest in education as you have done so well to this point. And I remind you of the great counsel of Benjamin Franklin, as he once said, an investment in knowledge pays the best interest. Amen.
Thank you, Rabbi Mansour. Reading of the journal.
In Senate, Tuesday, February 28th, the Senate met pursuant to adjournment. Journal of Monday, February 27th, was read and approved on motion. Senate adjourned.
Without objection, the journal will stand approved as read. Presentation of petitions, messages from the assembly, messages from the governor, reports of standing committees, reports of select committees, communications and reports from state officers, motions and resolutions.
Mr. President, on
Senator DeFrancisco.
On page 16, I offer the following amendments to calendar number 116, Senate print 874 by Senator Ort, and ask that said bill retain its place on the third reading calendar.
Can I have some order in the House, please? The amendments are received, and the bill shall retain its place on third reading, Senator DeFrancisco.
Can we now take up previously adopted resolution 758 by Senator Stuart Cousins, read it in its entirety, and call on Senator Stuart Cousins to speak.
Okay, I'm going to ask for some order in the House again, please. Secretary will read.
Legislative resolution number 758 by Senator Stuart Cousins, memorializing Governor Andrew M. Cuomo to proclaim March 2017 as Women's History Month in the state of New York. Whereas March is Women's History Month, and whereas March 8th is International Women's Day. And whereas each year New York State officially sets aside time to recognize the unique contributions that women have made to New York State. And whereas New York State has distinguished history of monumental achievements in the area of women's rights. And whereas in 1826, New York State opened one of the first public high schools for girls, resulting in a future for women in which they were no longer confined to the home. A future in which they were educated and able to use this education to better their social and economic status. And whereas in 1848 in New York, the first Women's Rights Convention was held at Seneca Falls to secure for all women the right to vote. And whereas in 1903, the Women's Trade Union League of New York was formed to represent women working, later becoming the nucleus for the International Ladies Garment Workers Union. And whereas in 1918, 1 year after New York guaranteed women the right to vote in all elections, the first two women, Ida Samus and Mary Lilly, were elected to the New York State Legislature. And whereas in 1967, Muriel Siebert became the first woman to own a seat on the New York Stock Exchange, opening the door for women to gain positions of greater economic power. And whereas in 1968, the New York State Assemblywoman Shirley Chisholm became the first black woman elected to Congress, and in 1972, she ran for President of the United States, another first for black women. And whereas in 1970, New York City was the site of the first women's strike for equality, in which 50,000 people marched for equal rights. And whereas in 1983, New York State women's legislators established the Legislative Women's Caucus to improve the participation of women in all areas of government, support issues that benefit women, and provide a network of support for women in the state legislature. And whereas in 2009, Sonia Sotomayor was the first Hispanic justice appointed to the United States Supreme Court. And whereas in 2014, four women from New York State participated in the Olympic events held in Sochi, Russia: Annalise Cook, Saranac Lake, biathlon; Jamie Grubel, Lake Placid, bobsled, earned a bronze medal; Aaron Hamlin, Remsen, luge, earned the bronze medal; and Josephine Pucci, Pearl Lake, women's hockey, earned a silver medal. And whereas in 2015, Loretta Elizabeth Lynch was appointed as Attorney General of the United States, becoming the first African-American woman to serve in this esteemed position. And whereas New York has been the home of many extraordinary women who have led society to a better future, Elizabeth Cady Stanton and Susan B. Anthony led the campaign for women's suffrage. Sojourner Truth spoke out for the abolition of slavery and for suffrage for women. And whereas Carrie Chapman Catt became the first president of the League of Women Voters, Emma Willard opened the first endowed institution for the education of women, Civil War surgeon Dr. Mary E. Walker was the only woman ever awarded the Congressional Medal of Honor, Harriet Tubman was an abolitionist who led the slaves to freedom by way of the Underground Railroad in the 19th century. And whereas Elizabeth Blackwell and Belva Lockwood were the first women in the fields of medicine and law, pioneer birth control educator and advocate Margaret Sanger established a research center in New York City. And whereas Emma Goldman founded the Free Speech League, which led to the American Civil Liberties Union, humanitarian Elizabeth Roosevelt served as United States delegate to the United Nations. And whereas civil rights lawyer and New York State Senator Constance Baker Motley became the first black woman to sit on the U.S. District Court in New York, and there have been so many more known and unknown women who champion rights and opportunity for all. And whereas New York State has hosted many conventions, campaigns, and events of the women's rights movement, from the 1848 convention at Seneca Falls to the 1999 Berkshire Conference of Women's Historians, which was held to improve the status of women in history and historical professions. And whereas today, 58 women serve in the New York State Legislature, holding leadership positions in both houses and bringing the diverse experiences of women into law and public policy, the largest class of women in the history of New York State. Now, therefore, be it resolved that this legislative body pauses deliberations to memorialize Governor Andrew M. Cuomo to proclaim March 2017 as Women's History Month in the state of New York, and be it further resolved that a copy of this resolution suitably engrossed be transmitted to the Honorable Andrew M. Cuomo, Governor of the State of New York, and the Legislative Women's Caucus of New York State.
Senator Stuart Cousins.
Thank you, Mr. President. I rise because it is such a privilege to serve in this body. It's certainly a privilege to be a woman in this body. It's certainly a privilege to be able to represent the aspirations of so many women and so many people in New York State. Over the weekend, the caucus weekend, I had my grandkids up and we looked at a lot of the paintings around and looked at the early depictions of the chamber where, again, there were no women allowed, no women allowed to even set foot on the floor here. Women were able to look down and see what was happening and what the business was that the men conducted. I took a picture in front of that painting because it was a reminder for me and a teaching tool for them of how far we've come and why it's important that the voices of everyone be brought to a legislative process. Earlier today, as women gathered to commemorate this year as the centennial for New York's women's right to vote, because we were able to begin voting in 1917 here in New York, but we couldn't vote on a national level until the ratification of the 19th Amendment. But it's been only 100 years since New York women were allowed to vote. When my mother was born, she technically could not vote. So when you look at how far we've gone, we have to remember that it's only been a short time. And so much has changed in the short time, but the fact is, so much of that change was pushed by women who understood that equality and justice was essential. When women come to the table, they bring their vision, but the vision is generally for a broader cross-section of the population. That's why you see the amount of activism of women right now in the streets of New York and all over the country. Women are realizing that they push so much of an agenda that's all-encompassing and really provides an opportunity for growth for everyone. And we also realize that we cannot go backwards. I was also saying earlier about someone named Frances Perkins, and I think it's just, again, crystallizes what women can bring to the table. When FDR became the president, he decided to appoint the very first woman to his cabinet, and that was a New York woman, Frances Perkins. Frances Perkins was in 1933 in the Department of Labor, and it is Frances Perkins that pushed the idea of Social Security, that pushed the idea of providing, after you had spent your time working and doing what you had to do, having a little something to prevent poverty. It is Social Security today that allows us to not have a higher impoverishment of our seniors as they retire. It was this woman, this New York woman, one of so many women whose names were read in the resolution, the women whose names will not be spoken, our mothers who went through so much in order to advantage us to be able to sit in these chambers, look at those pictures, realize how far we've come, realize how far we have to go, but also to realize the agitation, the input, and the vision of women help to get the society where it needs to be. We rise and we lift everyone as we rise. So thank you very, very much.
Thank you, Senator Stuart Cousins. Senator Alcantara.
Yes, hello. I would like to congratulate all my colleagues in the state Senate. Today we heard that it's a record number of women that are serving in the legislature, and that New York is not last like it used to be. It would be nice if New York and the United States in general can get up to par to other European nations where you have a high number of women serving in elected office. Women History Month is an opportunity for all of us to celebrate the accomplishment of women from all over New York, and to celebrate each other and to support each other. As the only Latina sitting in the state Senate, I know how tough it was for me to run for office. I would like to congratulate my colleagues, because I know that they probably had the same challenges that I did, regardless of your race and your background. And I think it's a great time that we get through the whole month of March to celebrate the accomplishment of women, not only in politics, but also in labor, housewives that have made the decision to stay at home, and that we can talk about all the achievement that we have. We saw for the first time a woman running, being the nominee of one of the two biggest parties in our country, and that she was able to make it that far. And regardless of our political affiliation, that's an achievement of itself, and it shows how far we have come as a society. Thank you.
Senator Sanders.
Thank you, Mr. President. You know me as State Senator Sanders, but today I want to give another title. I am the proud son of Mother Lois, my mother, who was a, in her own way, a pioneering woman who decided to move her children forward, and she showed me that women can do every single thing that anybody else can do in spite of the difficulties that may be launched on them. But I also stand because I have numerous aunts who upheld that. I have two sisters and I stand for them. I certainly stand for my three nieces and one granddaughter. Women hold up half the sky. If this world collapses, if we are going to be troubled with one way or another, it's because we didn't allow women to hold up their end. So we men really need to understand this, and the solution sometimes is not going to come from us. We're going to have to let women in, or else this planet's going to go down the drain. Every step forward for women has been a step forward for humankind. Every step forward that they have made has moved all people forward. And it's not just yesterday. We can look to women still organizing. The Million Women's March took place. And all over every continent that there is, I even heard they were marching in Antarctica. I can't understand that, but that's all right. I don't have to march with them in Antarctica, but I will march with them every place else. So the struggle is nowhere near over. Even in this state, we need to ratify that women get equal pay for equal work.
Right.
It's just ridiculous. We need to just codify this stuff and just say, all right, whatever foolishness, stupidity, I'll be kind, whatever backwardness we had years ago, we don't have it anymore. Women, if you could do the job, you get the pay. End of conversation. We need to defend people's rights to choose. All of these things that we shouldn't just have women in some theoretical on a pedestal, but side by side, fighting for moving the world forward to that beloved community that we should be trying to go to. So today is a day, and this month allows us to rededicate ourselves to ourselves, to rededicate ourselves to moving the human family forward, and we can do that by rededicating ourselves to the simple principle that women are equal to men. Thank you very much.
Senator Bailey.
Thank you, Mr. President. Apparently, I'm rather shy when it comes to speaking on resolutions. I want to thank my lead, Andrea Stewart Cousins, for introducing this resolution today. And Beyonce said, who runs the world? Girls. In my house, they certainly do. My house is run by my two little girls, Giada and Karina, and my wonderful wife, Giamara. They run my world. They are the reason why I'm in front of you today. Without them, I am nothing. I am also the grandson of Lena Bell Bailey and Flora Pittman. Without them, I am nothing. I am the proud son of Elmer T. Hunter Bailey. Without her, again, there's a theme, I am nothing. I was walking down the corridor today, and I was so pleased to see the artwork on the side on the way, and it made me stop and pause and just reflect about the role of women in my life and in all of your lives, that I'm sure. And it's such an amazing thing that women have made so many sacrifices for us, yet they lag behind us in pay. They lag behind us in representation. And I just want to say how happy I am to be in a conference led by Andrea Stewart Cousins, to be around so many amazing women in this body, not just my party, this entire body, that are doing positive things for the state of New York. And I talked about sacrifice, and as we begin this season of Lent, as I see many of my colleagues with ashes on their forehead, to talk about the ultimate sacrifice that was made, I think about the sacrifice that my mom made, and I will leave you with something from Tupac Shakur. There's no way I can pay you back, but the plan is to show you that I understand. You are appreciated. Thank you, Mr. President.
Senator Little.
Thank you, Mr. President. I just want to remind everyone that just a year ago, this body passed the legislation that created the Women's Suffrage committee and commission. And that commission met again today and reported on some of the activities. So we are underway celebrating the 100th anniversary of New York passing women's right to vote. And the many women in New York State and the many sites in New York State that people can visit and learn more about this history, women's history in New York State. So very happy. We have a website. We are going to be advertising, and as was mentioned, as you walk through the tunnel on the way over, some great posters from the women's movement. Also, in my own district, we had a woman who lived in New York City but summered in Essex County in the town of Lewis, Inez Milholland, and she is one of our women's history women that we are honoring this month. Inez Milholland only lived for 30 years, and she died actually speaking to a group in California, collapsed and died shortly after that, constantly promoting women's right to vote. She led the parade that happened February 12, 1917, when women marched from New York City to Washington, D.C. to lobby for the right to vote to that administration. And the picture, you probably have seen it before, she was all dressed in white on a white horse, but she was a New Yorker among the many other women who were New Yorkers. So this is a great month for us to recognize that, and I look forward to having you learn about all the other things we're going to be doing this year. Thank you.
Senator Prasad.
Thank you. I would just like to commend my leader for bringing the resolution to the floor. As we all know, as we celebrate Women's History Month, it is important to us women to acknowledge how far we've come and to acknowledge how far we still have to go. We still have a long way to go. And so to my colleagues, I encourage us all as women to keep fighting for us, keep fighting for the young girls we see each day. Keep telling them that it's okay. Their place will be here also. There is a place for them. And I just want to read something to you. It says, "Call me what you want, but I know who I am. I am her who wakes up before dawn and does not stop till the house is quiet. I am her who bears the pain because she knows that the future is what she births. I am her who fights for every one of her children and never lets go till they are safe. I am her who shoulders the weight so you can stand and be proud. I am her who steers are only seen by the night and meets the morning head on. I am her who will never quit, never stop, never faint till she is heard. I am woman." That's what we teach our young girls. We are women, and this is our month. Thank you all.
Senator Krueger.
Thank you, Mr. President. I also rise to thank my leader for introducing this resolution today and to stand proudly as a woman in the New York State Senate saying, we're 51% of the population. I'm thrilled we got the vote, but we have a long, long way to go. I'm thrilled that many of my male colleagues are standing up in support for equal treatment of women, but we still have a long, long way to go. We should have equal rights in our Constitution. We should have equal rights in every institution in the state of New York, and we should be represented in numbers that reflect our balance in the population. I've occasionally gotten up on the floor of the Senate when we do some kind of resolution on behalf of women, pointing out maybe it's Women's Equality Day, maybe it's Women's History Month, but I personally believe women should have equality all 365 days of each and every year. So I am proud to stand here as a woman who fights for equal rights for all in New York State. And I bet if all of us worked as hard to try to make sure that we had equal treatment for women in the state, we'd have gone so much further, and I hope we can. Thank you, Mr. President.
Senator Savino.
Thank you, Mr. President. I also rise. I want to thank Senator Stewart Cousins for sponsoring this resolution. And I join all of my colleagues in commemorating Women's History Month. I also want to particularly say to the gentleman in the chamber. We thank you for your support, and we thank you for the fact that you love us dearly. But you have an opportunity right now to help us, I think, a little bit more. We're in the midst of something for the next 6 weeks, four weeks, the budget process. And here's an opportunity to really show how much you honor women. We have a chance to really put our money where our mouth is and recognize that the traditional roles that have been imposed on women, in fact, have held us back. I am lucky in that I don't have any children, so I don't have to worry about balancing work life and my family life. But for millions of New York women, they have to do that every day. And we have a chance in this budget process to decide, are we going to put some of our child care dollars in place so we can level the playing field for those women who every day face that challenge? Are we going to try and figure out, are we going to use this budget process to lift women up so that we can have college affordability for all women? Because the best way for women to improve their economic circumstances is through education. We can do that in this budget process. We can work together, not just talking about how important women are, but showing how important women are in the way we spend the state's dollars and allocate resources, whether it's housing, education, childcare, social services. That's the best way to honor women and move them forward and lift them up. That's the best way for them to achieve equity in the workforce. When we recognize that those traditional roles that have held women back are still there, because women are still the primary childcare providers, we know that, and those things get in the way of their career, let's level that playing field for them in the way we can do it in the budget. So I want to congratulate everyone for recognizing women's history, but let's really make women's history with the state budget. Thank you, Mr. President.
The resolution was previously adopted on February 28th, yesterday. That concludes Speaker Senator DeFrancisco.
Would you please call on Senator Croce for an introduction?
Senator Croce.
Thank you, Mr. President. It's fitting and appropriate that we're talking about very dynamic women, women who've had an impact on our history, because today we're going to honor an organization that was founded by a very famous and dynamic woman, Clara Barton. And today we're honoring the American Red Cross. And I know that there are members of the different chapters of the American Red Cross here today in our gallery. For those of you who do not know, the American Red Cross responds to over 3,700 disasters a year. That's 10 a day. 12,000 individuals are helped every year by the American Red Cross. And whether it's financial assistance or healthcare assistance at the scene of a disaster, a bottle of water and a blanket and a clean towel, the American Red Cross is there. I would say that for those of us who had survived Superstorm Sandy, and I know there are a number of members who represent districts, when you're digging out somebody's living room of mud and debris because a storm has taken their house and the American Red Cross shows up on the street or at a nearby center, it's a breath of hope in a rather dire situation. So I'd like to honor, Mr. President, all of the men and women who have joined us today from the different chapters of the American Red Cross to thank them for their tireless efforts to help humanity. And I would like to also recognize the great woman who started the American Red Cross, Clara Barton. Mr. President.
Thank you, Senator Croce. We extend the privileges and we welcome you of the House, and we welcome you to the Senate today, and thank you for your service to our communities across the state and nation. Please rise and be recognized. Senator DeFrancisco.
Would you please take up the non-controversial reading of the calendar?
And the Secretary will read.
Calendar number 80 by Senator Serino, Senate Print 2159, enact amend the penal law.
Last section.
Section 2, this act should take effect on the 1st of November.
Call roll.
Addabbo, Flanagan, Klein, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes. Ayes 59, nays 1. Senator Montgomery recorded in the negative.
Bill's passed.
Calendar number 110 by Senator Ort, Senate Print 726A, enact amendment to general municipal law.
Last section.
Section 3, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Flanagan, Klein, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 58, nays 2, Senators Diaz.
Sanders.
Ayes 57, nays 3, Senators Diaz, Krueger, and Sanders, recorded in the negative.
Bill's passed.
Calendar number 162 by Senator Little, Senate Print 2582, enact amend the penal law.
Last section.
Section 3, this act should take effect on the 1st of November.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Flanagan, Klein, Stewart, Cousins, Young.
Senator Little to explain her vote.
Thank you, and thank everyone for voting for this bill. This is a bill that would make it a criminal crime for an employee of a school district to have a relationship with any student in that school district. Many of these employees, administrators, teachers are persons of power and trust, and despite the fact that the legal age for consent to sexual activity is 17, it is inappropriate that anyone working in a school have a relationship like this with a student. And I thank everyone for their vote on this. I look forward to having it pass in the Assembly. We do have Assembly sponsors.
Senator Little to be recorded in the affirmative. Announce the results.
Aye, 60.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 167 by Senator Flanagan, Senate Print 3525.
Last section.
An act to amend the penal law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act should take effect on the 90th day.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Flanagan, Klein, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59, nays 1. Senator Sanders recorded the negative.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 174 by Senator Croce, Senate Print 1854A, an act to amend the public authorities law.
Last section. Bill will be laid aside for the day.
Calendar number 193 by Senator Carlucci, Senate Print 1206, enact amend Lawrence Law.
Read the last section.
Section 2 of this act should take effect immediately.
Call roll.
Addabbo, Flanagan, Klein, Stewart, Cousins, Young.
Senator Carlucci to explain his vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. I want to thank the members of this body for supporting this legislation. Unfortunately, right now in New York State, over 10,000 men, women, and children are waiting for a life-saving organ transplant. And unfortunately, in New York, we've lagged behind almost every state in the nation when it comes to the percentage of eligible people enrolled in the organ donor program. This legislation that we're voting on today would make Lawrence Law permanent. And that's named after Lauren Shields, who's been a tireless advocate to increase organ donation. We know by increasing organ donation, increasing the amount of eligible people to enroll, we will save people's lives. And so what this legislation does is it simply asks the question, when you go to the DMV, because 97% of the people that enroll in the organ donor program do it through the Department of Motor Vehicles. So now we ask the question, would you like to be an organ donor? Yes, or skip the question. We've seen an increase from the time that this bill had been going into effect from 11% rate of people enrolling to 17% now. So we're making a big difference. That means we have over 1 million people that have enrolled to be an organ donor in New York State since Lawrence Law has been fully implemented. This legislation would make it permanent. We're moving in the right direction. Let's keep that momentum going. And in doing that, we will save people's lives. So I want to thank my colleagues for supporting this legislation, particularly Senator Hannan, who's really helped us and guide us through this process of making sure we're doing everything we can to increase organ donation here in New York State. So, Mr. President, I vote aye. Thank you.
Senator Carlucci to be recorded in the affirmative. Announce the results.
Aye, 60.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 194 by Senator Hannan, Senate Print 1870, enact amend the social services law.
Last section.
Section 2, this act should take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Flanagan, Klein, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 60.
Bill's passed.
Calendar number 195 by Senator Hannan, Senate Print 2495, enact amend the public health law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act should take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Flanagan, Klein, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 60.
And the bill is passed. Senator DeFrancisco, we have finished with the non-controversial reading of today's active list calendar.
Is there any further business at the desk?
There is no further business at the desk.
That being the case, I move to adjourn until Thursday, March 2nd at 11 a.m.
On motion, the Senate will stand adjourned until Thursday, March 2nd at 11 a.m. The Senate stands adjourned.